So good evening, everybody. We are in almost Rosh Chodesh Tevet, and we're gonna try and talk about a little bit about conflicts and about how can we resolve conflicts, or better say, what the Torah is saying, or what I found in the Torah that I think it's saying. I mean, nobody's saying it, I'm saying it, but I hope I can prove it from what we have. So we are the one parasha before the end of Chumash Bereshit, Parashat Vayigash, and we are in the midst of a huge drama between Yosef and his brothers. Rav Yonatan Zaks, Alav HaShalom, is saying that we need to focus on the fact that it's interesting that one third of Chumash Bereshit is talking about Yosef. One third. It's like unbelievable. Well, the first parasha of Bereshit is Parashat Bereshit is 1,000 years and it's just one parasha. And third of all the Chumash is talking about Yosef. It's like a continuum of parashot Vayeshev, Miketz, Vayigash, and the last one, Vayechi. And it's actually the longest story in the Torah, like the biggest, longest story of the Torah. And the hero of the story is Yosef. And even though this is what we see in Chumash Bereshit, we are not called Yosefim. The people of Yosef, we're not called Yosef. Yosefa, Yosefo, no, we are called Yehudim. And Yehudim comes from the name of his brother, Yehuda, not from Yosef. So it's like, it's puzzling. How come such a huge chunk of the Torah, of the Chumash, the longest story ever told with one hero in the Torah, is about Yosef, and still we are not called after him. We are called after his brother, Yehuda. So let's see what's going on. And it's interesting because Yehuda, as far as we know from the story, wasn't such a nice person. He was, Yosef was thrown into the pit. He was begging for his life. And all the brothers seated outside and ate as if nothing is happening. And Yehuda is saying to them, we're not going to gain anything from just letting him die. Let's sell him to the Ishmaelim. What kind of apathy? What kind of indifference is that? What's going on over here? How come this person that's suggesting to sell his brothers to Gentiles and, you know, get rid of him becomes the person that we are called after him? It's a good question, נכון? It's a good question. So let's do a little recap from all the chapters before, because we are not meeting every week. All the brothers of Yosef hating him because he's beloved son of their father Yaakov. Yaakov is spoiling him. He's giving him kutonet pasim, a special garment to wear. He has dreams about wheat and that bow to him, about the star and the moon and all the stars are bowing to him, like grandiose dreams. And it came to the point where his brother were so jealous and so envious of him, they didn't even look at him and say shalom. Like, no, hi, how are you? It says in the Torah, ויראו אחיו, כי אותו אהב אביה מכל אחד, וישנאו אותו ולא יכלו לדבר לשלום. They saw that their father loved him the most, so they hated him. This is what the Torah said. They hated him and couldn't even speak and say shalom to him. This is how much they were apart from their brother. So at some point, Yaakov is sending Yosef to look for his brothers. But we know the end of the story. Yaakov, Yosef is not coming back. His father is sending him, but he doesn't come back. And at that moment in time, this is where the prophecy of what Hashem told to Avraham Avinu started to manifest. This is when it's starting. When Hashem said בברית בין הבתרים, he said to Abraham, ידוע תדע כי גר יהיה זרעך בארץ לא להם. You should know that your offsprings are going to be stranger in a land that is not theirs. ועבדום ועינו אותם 400 שנה. They will be slaved and tortured for 400 years. So this is basically when it's all started, because Yosef is being sold and sent away to Egypt. When Yosef is finally finding his brothers, they see him come and they are saying, here he comes, the one with the dreams, let's kill him and let's throw him to the pit, and we're going to tell our father that a bad animal, an evil animal ate him, and then we see what dreams he's going to have. They want to get rid of him. Ashkara getting rid of them. Reuven was the one that said, let's not have anything to do with killing our brother. Let's just throw him to the pit, and if he dies, he dies. But at least we are not the one killing him. As if throwing somebody to a pit he cannot get out by himself from is not actually killing him. But okay, it's not really, you know, shedding blood. While they're sitting next to this pit and enjoying a meal, while their brother is, you know, crying for his life, Yehuda is saying to his brother, מה בצע כי נהרוג אותו וכיסינו את דמו? What are we going to gain from killing our brother and conceal his blood with some dirt? לכו ונמכרנו לישמעאלים, let's sell him to the Ishmaelim, וידנו אל תהי בו, and then we are as if we didn't do anything wrong to him, because after all he is our brother, he is our flesh and blood, and his brothers agreed, said, what's the point? We're going to get rid of him, at least we're going to gain something from it. So they take Yosef out of the pit, and they're sending to the Ishmaelim, Ishmaelim sending him to the Midianim, Midianim sending him, selling him back to the Ishmaelim, Ishmaelim selling him to Potiphar. He gets to Potiphar, the minister of the cooks, and of Paro in Mitzrayim. Yosef is continuing his life in Mitzrayim. He was, you know, foreign to his brothers in his homeland, and now he is foreign in another country. He's still divided and separated from his family. He was separated before, but now he's really separated. There's nobody there for him. And also there's nothing is familiar, that is familiar. It's a totally different place, totally different culture, and he's in the in the palace of the king. It's 22 years. We are talking about a period of time of 22 years that he is in Egypt, 13 years passing until he becomes the right hand of Potiphar, and his wife, Potiphar's wife, is trying to seduce him. He's running away from her, leaving his coat, and she says, she's accusing him that he tried to rape her, and that's why the coat is there, and he's being sent to prison. And 12 years he is in prison until he comes out, and once he does, once Paro is calling him, it's like immediately. It said vayaritzu min habor. The moment Paro decided that the time is up, Hashem decided the time is up, vayaritzu min habor, they run him out. Like, it was so fast, so quickly, they replaced his clothes from being a prisoner to being the prince of Egypt again. And he's 30 when he's becoming second to the king, second to Paro. And Paro made him responsible for the entire land. Of course, after he solved his dream, I'm not telling the whole story, we all know the story, I'm just, you know, being like recap. So Yosef in actuality ruled over Mitzrayim for 80 years until he was 110. And according to our records, it's the longest time somebody was a king. Anybody from Am Yisrael that became a king, from all the kings that we have, from all the rulers that we had, Yosef was the one that ruled the longest until he was 110. It's mind-blowing that Yehuda, that we are called after him, was the one that says, Ma betza, let's gain something from all of this. Let's make money out of our brother's misery. It's mind-blowing. It's really hard to understand how somebody can be so heartless. How can you be so cold? What happened over here? And really, when we look on relationship, we see that we can get to a point in any relationship. It doesn't have to be marriage. It can be in our jobs, with our bosses or co-worker or with friends. It can be that we are starting in a place where we are in a very close or feel like we're in a good relationship. And in time, it becomes to a place where we like don't care about each other. And not only don't care about each other, we are doing not nice things to each other. Talk about each other, ignoring each other, not helping, ignoring from the fact that, you know, you see somebody that used to be your friend and needs help, and you say, "Lo ra'iti, I didn't see, I'm continuing." We get to those points, and it's really mind-blowing to understand how we, as people, that each and every one of them perceive themselves as a good person, can get to those points, and we all get there. There's no way that we don't. We all get there. Some more, some less, some more aware of it, some less aware of it, but we all get to those points where we can go in the street and see somebody that needs something, and we see as we make ourselves as if we didn't see. So we're not going to have to stop and help, assist, even if it's not a friend. We all get there. Anyway, so when we look on relationships, like on real relationships, how they start, whether it's business or marriage or friendships, doesn't matter. What brings people together is that each and every one wants to receive something from the other person that he's lacking. This is what attracts us to each other. We all going around in this world with voids and something that is missing or empty in us. And when we are recognizing this thing in other people, we are attracted to them. This is what it is. We are not always aware of it, but this is where relationship starts. You have something I need. I have something you need. It's not something we talk about. It's not something we are aware of usually, but this is what attracts us to each other, and this is why we are deciding to have a relationship. So when we're talking about business, it's really obvious. It's very hard, easy to understand. Let's say somebody wants to sell a house, and another person wants to buy a house. Okay? So the one that wants to sell, this is what he misses now. He missing in his life somebody that's going to buy his house, right? The one that wants to buy a house is missing in his life a house. He's looking to buy a house. So when we're looking on business transaction, it's very clear to us. Of course, he has something to sell. This one has something to buy. They need something from each other. So they do a contract. They have a relationship, right? They have to decide on the price. There's all kind of stuff, but the initial interest comes from the fact that this one wants to sell and this one wants to buy. In a relationship, when we're talking about feelings and emotion, it's a little more tricky and it's less obvious, but it's the same principle. Somebody has something to sell and the other one wants to buy it, and vice versa. This one has something to sell that the other one wants to buy, and it fits. So that's why a relationship is being built. So the relationship basically growing out of need in satisfying needs or wants, whether it's physical or emotional, but some of the one that are based only on satisfying physical and monetary, yes, monetary or physical attraction, sexual, those relationships usually are very short term. There's nothing to hold them for a very long time, because once each side got what they want and the void is being filled, there's no need for the other person anymore. So there's no interest anymore. So those partnerships usually are being dissolved. There's no continuous. When we are talking about emotional connections, about emotional voids that needs to be filled and are being filled, then it's different, because we are investing in one another. We're not taking just something that is physical or tangible. It's something emotional, something that has to do with our emotions. So we are basically driven in our life by two forces, only two forces, either pleasure or suffering. Whatever gives us pleasure, we want more of, and whatever gives us suffering, we want to get away from. This is what we do. If it's not pleasurable, we're not going to be motivated to look for it and to do something to get it. And if it's causing us suffer or discomfort, we want to avoid it and go away from. Otherwise, if there's no pleasure or suffering, we won't move. We just stay in one place and we're not going to move. In Hebrew, the letters of pleasure is oneg, and which is something positive and pleasant. When we scrabble those letters, it becomes nega. Nega is like a blemish. It's the same letters. So we have blemish, which is something unpleasant and negative. So it all depends where it's coming from. But it's the same thing, it's the same force, it's the same energy, just depending where it comes from, where the how the letters are organized.
Or to who? Every person something feels different. What's suffering to you might be pleasure to me, and vice versa.
This is one thing, and by Mama Tekteni. This is one thing, and the other thing which is important to remember is that it's a choice. It's also a choice, because you can perceive something or experience something as being unpleasant. But when you think about it, you can choose to perceive it differently. We can find examples about that, but we need to understand. Example, for a year now, I didn't eat white flour. Not until now, a week ago I ate sphinge, but today, so for a year, boy. So for a year, I didn't eat white flour. I had to convince myself that the thing that I love the most, which is bread, is not good, because otherwise I would suffer very much, right? How can you not eat something that you really, really like? It's very different. I would suffer every day. So I convinced myself that it's not really that tasty. I would smell the challah and eat the carton of the spelt. And that's it.
Did it work?
Yes. I tell you, I didn't eat for a year.
Until
the sphinx and this.
Wait, you didn't eat it with pleasure?
The spelt? Yeah. I found ways to enjoy it.
I make a good one. What do you do?
As this is not taim kmo lechem lavan.
So for Shabbat, take a bite.
No.
No, because when you take one bite, then you want the second.
Yeah.
But you get it out of your system.
No, it's not.
It triggers the...
Because it triggers.
Yeah.
Your glucose levels increase.
So the next day, it was much more difficult for me not to eat another sphinge. And look at all the sphinge that everybody eating and not to eat it, because I knew if I'm going to cave today, so tomorrow I'm going to cave again, and I'm done with a year of work. No, no, חבל. So again, this was just an example how we take something that is pleasurable to us, and by choice we make it as if it's not pleasurable for us, so we can do what we need to do. In a relationship, it's the same. We can look at somebody and say, oh, this is really annoying. This habit of my husband is annoying, like I don't know what, and it's going to cause me suffer. It's going to cost me suffering. It's going to cost me unpleasant feelings. So it's going to be very unpleasant to be around each other, because all the energy and the feelings are not pleasant, right? It's not oneg. It's nega. It's uncomfortable. However, I can choose to think that it's not so annoying. Not so bad. And then the energy changes. So we need to remember that there's a choice here. And we're going to see that. So Yosef is the Mashbir Kol Haaretz. He's the Gormeglat of Egypt. He is responsible for all the food. And his dreams are coming true. His brother comes to Mitzrayim because there's a famine in Eretz Israel, in Canaan. And they're looking for food. Yaakov is sending them to look for food. And they do come and they bow to him the same way he dreamt about it in his dream. He's already married. He has children on his own. And it's interesting because Yosef is recognizing his brothers, but they don't recognize him because he has no beard. He is dressed like the Egyptians with all those... like half naked and shaved, and it's described in the Midrash with a golden something, I don't remember, but he doesn't look like somebody that can be their brothers. And another thing that Rabbani is saying, that there was no way for them even to think about maybe it is their brother, because in their mind he's dead, he's gone. They sold him to the Ishmaelim, and in their mind he's not here anymore. So Yosef decides to put his brothers to the test and see if anything changed since way back then. Did they learn something from what happened? Did it shook them enough to change them, what they did to him? So he wanted to create a nisayon, a test that it's going to be similar to what he went through with them, something similar. So he manifested whatever that's going to, like, orchestrated, produced, whatever you want to call him, to call it a situation that they're going to have to bring their youngest brother, Benjamin, his brother, from Canaan to Egypt, knowing that this king, this crazy king, that they gave him money and he gave them the money back, and then he planted... chalice in their bags, and then he wants to put them in prison and make them their slaves, and he's asking them to bring their brother and asking them, how is your father? And then he sits them around the table according to their age, exactly to the way they were born, and they are puzzled, they don't understand what's going on. And our parashayin for last week is ending in a way, in a place where there's no solution. Okay? Yosef is insisting to bring Benjamin over, and Yehuda is asking please don't do that. I'm going to be the guarantor. I'm going to be instead of him. Take me instead of him. It's like you have a hostage situation and a policeman is volunteering himself to replace one of the hostages. So the crook is going to have somebody to point the gun to, but it's not going to be an innocent person. So Yehuda is volunteering. He said, I'm going to be this one. I'm going to replace this Binyamin that you want. I cannot do this to my father. My father suffered so much. I cannot do this to my brother, to my father again. So here we see that something changed. From this Yehuda that sat next to the pit, eating lunch with his brother, saying, what are we going to gain just from leaving him here? Let's sell him with indifference and no sympathy at all. To a person that is fighting a ruler, a king, the second to the king of Egypt. It's like vice president of America, like, you know, who are you to fight with him? Not to bring his younger brother and to please replace, let him sit instead of him. He says, "Ve'ata yeshevna avdecha tachat hanar, eved le'adoni." I'm your slave. Please let me sit instead of the lad, and I'll be a slave to you. And the boy, he's gonna go back with his brothers, back to my father, because he says, "Ech ele al avi ve'anar enenu iti." How am I going to go back to my father, and the lad is not with me? Which was the same scenario when they came back from the not the desert. They were roim. No, how do we say roim?
Shepherd.
When shepherding, they came back with the cattle, and the lad was not with them.
How old were they? That's the first time.
I don't know. I looked and I don't know.
Can't that be a factor in their choices?
Listen, we know that Yosef was the youngest.
Reuben was the oldest.
Reuben was the oldest and Yosef was the youngest. So I think they were teenagers because they were all by themselves shepherding the
cattle. When they told him, he was already trying to be with Potiphar, wanting him. He couldn't be too
young. No, not immediately. It took 13 years.
Oh, so he could have been stupid boys. Been 7.
They were stupid boys.
Yeah. And he's continuing and saying, Penere bara asher imtza et avi. That God forbid that I'll see all these bad things that are going to happen to my father. It definitely, Yehuda, what happened with Yosef, left an impression of him on him that is for sure puts me in a place where he's willing to fight, really to fight with the ruler of Egypt, not to leave Benjamin over there. He doesn't want to repeat the same story. He said, as if he's saying, I learned my lesson. I'm not going to do this again. Yes, he did. And now this parasha is beginning with the word Vaigash. Vaigash el av Yehuda. Not only he's speaking to him, he's approaching him. He's coming closer to him. Imagine this picture, like this king sitting on his throne, or whatever, with all the servants, the Egyptian servants that for sure had weapons with them, protecting the ruler. And these are like, you know, shepherds. And not only he is talking to him, not agreeing with him, arguing with him, he's approaching him. I mean, the CIA is going to jump on him. It's dangerous. It's a dangerous situation. So he is approaching Yosef and he's saying to him, please allow me to speak to you. Please hear me. Hear what I have to say. Don't get upset with me because I have respect for you because you are the same as Paro. I have respect to you as if you are Paro. In Hebrew it says, Vayigash elav Yehuda vayomer bi Adoni. Yedaber na avdecha davar beozne Adoni ve'al icharapcha beavdecha ki kamocha keparo. I have the most respect to you. I'm not trying to disrespect you. So it looked like as if Yehuda is
mitchanef.
Brown, brown nose.
Okay, brown, okay. It looks like it. It looks like it. It looks like it's is behaving with no reason, irrationally, like you're not thinking what you're doing. But it's not. This is a tactic. This is a way of Yehuda wants to achieve something, so he's doing everything he can to
convince.
Not to convince, to achieve what he wants. And Yosef is also pretending, because inside of him, he just waits for the second he can throw this custom away from him, off him, and reveal himself to his brothers. He misses them too. He wants to let them know, listen, everything's fine. It's just a show over here. It's just a game. I'm just testing you. And Yehuda is jumping heads first to a pool that he doesn't even know if there's water in it. He's just not willing to repeat the same story. Maybe he's afraid. I don't know if he's afraid or not, but what we do know from this scenario, from this scene, that even though he's standing in front of the ruler of Egypt, there's something that is more important to him than whatever might happen to him. His brother and his father. Something that wasn't there before, the last time. Now he doesn't think about himself. He doesn't think about what am I going to gain from this. He's thinking about how am I going to make my father miserable again. How am I going to hurt my brother again. I cannot do that. So we see that Yehuda is not willing to repeat the same mistake again. And he's not saying it, but we understand that he is admitting that back then he did something wrong, and now he is willing to lasot tshuva and not repeat, even if it's going to cost him his life. Because he doesn't know how this person that is standing, this cuckoo that's doing all kind of strange stuff, is going to react to him, not only speaking to him, but also approaching him physically. So Yehuda is basically justifying his name. Because Yehuda was named Yehuda because Leah, his mother, when he was born, he was the fourth son, said, "Hapam odet Hashem." This time I'm going to say thank you to Hashem. She had Reuven, she had Shimon, she had Levi, Reuben, Shama Hashem to my sorrow. Levi, I'm going to have some, my husband is going to be with me, he's going to accompany me. And now the fourth child, she said, Hapam odet Hashem. Now I'm going to say thank you to Hashem. So, odeh, hodaya, to say thank you, this is in English, but in Hebrew it has two meanings. Lehodot is one, to say thank you, but lehodot is also admitting the truth, when confessing, basically. When you have a witness in a court and they are confessing to their crime, they are modim on their crime. It's the same exact word as saying thank you. So we need to understand how come Yehuda is justifying his name this way. So we understand that Yehuda grew up, some years passed. Something happened to him during those years that brought him to this place where he sees things differently and is willing to, like, jump on his sword, basically, in just not to repeat the same mistake again. He changed. Something happened and he changed. So there's a phenomena that is connected to vision, and it's called presbyopia. It's a phenomena that happens around the age of 40 and up, that people cannot see things from here, and they need to do this in order to see.
They do it
for it. Yeah. 40 onwards, right? So it's called presbyopia, and it's like this motion of from close I cannot see it, but if I'll move it far enough from me, I'll have another perspective, and I'm gonna see the bigger picture. There's a way to see the bigger picture and the details in the pictures that I couldn't see from close. So it's interesting that it's in this age the same phenomena also happens emotionally, mentally also, because 40 is called Gila Bina. Bina is wisdom. So in this age, most people become more wise. They have a better perspective of life. They can see a bigger picture than they could see before. So something is changing when you are growing up. But if you're using those tools or those changes that naturally happens with your vision, even if whether it's physical or mentally, emotionally, then you can achieve other things that you wouldn't achieve without that, without utilizing those tools that you're getting with age, when you're getting them with age. So we see that this is what happened to Yehuda, and we find this turn of event in him in the middle of Parashat Vayeshev. In the middle of Parashat Vayeshev, in the middle of all the story of Kutonet Pasim and the selling of Yosef and the story about the wife of Potiphar that made this story, that lied the story about him and about Yosef going to prison for 12 years. In the midst of all of that, the Torah is suddenly pausing the story in the middle of the parasha and tell us a whole different story, as if it's not connected to anything. But it's so connected because this is the turning point for Yehuda. And this is what happened. Yehuda had three sons. He married, he took a wife to his first son, his name was Er. And the wife's name was Tamar. He married Er, his son, to Tamar. But Er was Er, if you, again, switch the letter, is Ra. Not good, the opposite of good. Er was not good in the eyes of Hashem, and he died. So, according to the Jewish law, Yibum, Yehuda gave Tamar, his second son, which his name was Onan. Whoever knows Hebrew understand what he was doing, which was not pleasant in the eye of Hashem, and Onan died as well. The reason Onan did that, he didn't want Tamar to have his child that's going to be considered his brother's child. He didn't want that. So he worked manually, and Hashem didn't like it and killed him too. Yehuda had another third son named Shiloh, and he said, listen, this one is a man killer. I'm not giving her another child. He told her, listen, he's too young to get married. Go home to your father, sit with your father. As soon as he is going to grow enough to get married, I'm going to call you. And Tamar went to her father and waited and waited and waited. Shiloh grew. But Yehuda didn't call her, and she understood he lied to her. He's not going to give her Shiloh, but she wanted a son from this family. She needed a son from this family, so she wore a costume of a working lady and went into the fields. And went into the field where she knew Yehuda is gonna pass. While all this is happening, Yehuda's wife died also. So he was a widow. Yeah, he was a widow. So she sat on on the hills over there. She made a little tent and sat over there with in something in her costume, covered in her face was covered. And Yehuda came. Yehuda came and he said, how much? How much? And she told two goats. That's it. Two goats. No.
Two goats for what?
For the work.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. Sorry.
Okay. This is what this was a rate. Hey, fuck you, that. Yes, huh? So he told her, listen, I'm sorry, I don't have any goats with me right now. Sit tight, I'm going to go back to my village and I'm going to send my my servant with two goats. She said, no, this is not going to happen. I don't know if you're going to come back. Give me a ravon, guarantee.
Collateral.
I need a collateral. Okay. So he said, what do you want? So she said, I want your stuff. I want your ring with the one you are making the seal with. And I want your belt. This is what I want. And he said, no problem. I leave it with you. And in a few hours, I'm going to send my servant. Of course, by the time the servant came, there was no tent, no tamar, no nothing. He asked the other shepherd, did you see this working ladies? And there's no working lady. Nobody's here. It's not their corner here. They work in a different place. I don't know what you're talking about. But yeah, it's not their mountain.
It's not their territory.
Yeah. Anyway, he went back. He said to Yehuda, listen, I don't find her. And Yehuda said, okay. I lost my staff and ring and belt. Lo nora. A few months going by, and a rumor start going around. Zanta Tamar kalatcha v'gam hara lizanunim. Your daughter-in-law Tamar became a whore, and she is now pregnant from being a whore.
Her custom
wasn't
that good.
Yeah. And this offense is the verdict is death. You need to be burned.
Okay, so which son is she? So who did she marry?
She didn't marry anybody.
She got pregnant from Yehuda.
Oh, okay, she died. Okay.
Who died?
Two wives.
Yehuda wives died, not Tamar.
No, Tamar was married to his first son that died. And then married her off to the second
son who died.
And she wanted the third son, he didn't want to
marry. Right. No.
But she was his daughter-in-law from the first
son. But she fooled around with Yehuda.
She went to the dad.
She fooled around with Yehuda.
She fooled around with me.
Yes, she did.
Yes, she did.
Oh, they waited. No, they didn't. She did the work.
No,
she did the work.
She did the work.
She did.
Yeah, so she wasn't waiting for the goat. Do we need a PowerPoint presentation that Tayela left?
She left with the ring, with the stuff, and with the belt.
Until the goat came back.
Okay.
She started the work herself, yeah?
So now she's being called to Yehuda, which was the president of the clan, of the area, and he ruled... You hoard, so you need to be sentenced to death by burning. You need to be burned. So she said to the people that were imprisoning her, before you taking me, please give this to Yehuda and tell him the person that gave me this is the person that responsible for my pregnancy. And she sent the staff and the ring and the belt to Yehuda. She didn't say anything about Yehuda got me pregnant. She just said, give this to Yehuda and let him know that the person that these items belong to, he is the person that is responsible for my pregnancy.
Wow.
Yes.
Seriously.
And Yehuda... could ignore it. could take it and say nothing and still burn her. He could do whatever he wanted because he was the president. And what did Yehuda do? He said, I admit I did her.
Wow.
You were so careful that all the other words that you did.
That translation doesn't go well.
Listen, it wasn't clear to Maureen before, so now it's going to be clear.
Rabbi! I knew they did it. I didn't know about it. That's wonderful. This wasn't in any of the
parashas. Yes, Parashat
Vayeshev. You were absent that day. They said that in Yeshiva. Oh, that's...
But not only that, he came out from his chambers and told everybody, Tamar tzadka mimeni. She is more righteous than me.
Why?
Why?
Because she didn't shame him.
But she tricked him into sleeping with her.
No,
it's
in the family.
She has to get married to Shiloh anyway.
At the end of the day, she didn't throw him under the bus.
No.
She was willing to just go with it.
She was willing not to embarrass him.
She didn't rat.
Yeah.
But I feel like she tricked him.
Yes, she did, because he tricked her.
No, but
oh, because she didn't give her rights.
She loved. He tricked her. So Tamar from this pregnancy have twins, Zerach and Peretz. Peretz was the great 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 sixth generation back of Boaz, who got married with Ruth.
Wow.
And she was the grandmother of David HaMelech. From him, Mashiach is going to come.
Wow.
So just see the twist, the whole story, where it goes.
So you could still do something bad and still...
But she didn't do anything bad according to the halacha.
Back then.
Wait, but you can still have sex before you get married, it's okay.
What's the same family?
It has to stay in the family back then.
It has to stay.
What's the story?
The Yibum.
Why? It's like my brother and it's okay?
Yes.
זה החוקים של אז.
זה החוקים של אז, הוא עובד רוב את הברדה.
יש של פעם.
The brother always looked at the dead brother's
wife.
This is the halacha. It's called Yibum.
What?
This is the halacha. Well, nobody does it today, but this is the halacha.
Oh my God.
If you don't have children, you could sleep with your...
So,
brother-in-law.
Oh, he married. She did marry them.
No, we're talking about the father.
The father deceived her from a business transaction.
Right.
A marriage is a business transaction.
Oh, the first one.
All marriage is a business transaction. And הכתובה שלך גם כן business. 200 שקלים כסף,
כאילו אני אכנו מקבל את זה.
תשמעי, it is.
פעם זה היה עולם.
כן, כן. So, we understand the change in Yehuda. We see what happened to Yehuda. Something happened, and this is why this story is in the midst of this third chumash that is all about Yosef, because there's a meaning to this sipur that is coming to the end of where we are standing right now. Vaygash, that I'm gonna die on this. I'm not gonna let it happen again. I am a corrected person. I learned from my mistake. I am admitting the truth. I am thinking about what I have. I'm not looking to have anything I don't have. Whatever started this animosity between the brother was jealousy, mm-hmm, or envy. I don't know in English what's the difference between the two, or one of them.
Yeah.
We need to remember that each conflict, when there's a conflict, it always starts because one or both parties are feeling hurt. They feel hurt. It doesn't necessarily mean that one tried to hurt the other, but it does mean that whoever start to be less pleasant in the relationship is the one that's being hurt or feels hurt. So they're lashing out. I'm hurt, I'm going to hurt you now. Again, it's not always something that people are aware of, but we all do it. Yeah? You can see it very clearly with children. They sit in the sandbox, and one of them is giving the other one like this, so the other one take a... it's human nature. This is what we do. So when we are grown up, we are more controlled over our bodies, but emotionally, we react almost the same if we are not really aware of what we are doing. So if you catch yourself reacting in an offensive way, try to understand that you are hurt right now. Otherwise, you wouldn't behave that way. The only reason you behave that way is because you hurt. So if you develop some kind of awareness to yourself, you can learn a lot about yourself, about what's hurting you. Where is your... where is like weak spots or tender spots that are triggering this kind of reaction from you. We don't want to be perceived weak, not to other people and definitely not to ourselves. We want to feel that we are strong and good. And this is why we are reacting the way you're reacting. So what your dad did was amazing because he was the president of the whole Shevet Yehuda. And still, he could do whatever he wants. Who is this Tamar? Everybody thinks she's a whore. She's nothing. And still, he had enough self-dignity to get up and say, Tzadka Mimeni. She is the righteous one, not me. She is the one that is on the right side, not me. So, we understand that when two people are more invested emotionally, the more emotionally invested you are in a relationship, the more it's going to be difficult to do this work of staying together and getting along. Because the more emotions are involved, the more hurt you're going to get. The more close you are, the more pain you have. But you also have a lot of pleasure. So it's the same amount. Or the same intensity, let's say that, not the same amount, the same intensity of how painful a relationship can be, the same intensity can be pleasurable. Remember that we said there are two channels, only two. One is Ham. One is pleasure and the other one is suffer. So it doesn't matter which one it is. When a relationship is and when there's emotions are involved, it's going to be the same intensity on both sides. So we're in the winter now, winter time.
He big shateyot.
And I think Motzei Shabbat was the 60 day after החגים, after חשבן, כאילו, when we finished the חגים, so we started to say, ותן טל ומטר, בתפילת 18, whoever is praying, that we changed in the תפילה from what we usually say in the summer, to what we usually say in the winter. So, over here we have enough of water, but בארץ ישראל, it's not the same story. So the geshem is really, really needed. So this prayer, when you do pray it, please have in mind ארץ ישראל. Over here they have the Niagara Falls, they don't need anymore. They have enough. So think about ארץ ישראל that needs geshem. Over there they need a lot of geshem. So... הרבנית ימים המזרחית, she knows how to play with the Hebrew language, which is amazing. She's saying that Geshem, which is rain, is two words. Gash Sham. Go there. This is Geshem, those two words, which is a meeting, meaning that the skies are going down to the earth and they are meeting with the rain is the chomrim.
The
sky is meaning the... Sochen HaChibur.
The dealer.
No, no, no. Agent. 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 No. It's like the agent of the...
Connection?
Of the connection, yes. But in order to do that, the Geshem needs to approach the earth, right? There's not going to be any connection unless the rain is going to come down, right? As long as the Geshem is staying over there, there's not going to be any connection with earth. The same way, there's not going to be any connection if you don't do this step and going approaching somebody else. Meaning, if we are looking for connection in our relationships, one of us need to do the approaching. If both of us are standing and unwilling to move, so heaven are not going to meet earth, and earth is not going to meet heaven. There has to be lageshet. It has to be vaigash. It has to be this approaching. Somebody needs to do this. One of us needs to do that. And it's frightening to do that, because when we do that, we are exposing ourselves. We are exposing what's weak with us, within us, what's sensitive, yes, what's sensitive, what's vulnerable within me when I'm doing this approach. Think about Yehuda. He's approaching Yosef and he tells him, I cannot go like this back to my father. I cannot see my father suffering like this again. He's revealing what's his weakest point right now. He's telling him, this I cannot bear. This is too sensitive for me. I'm too vulnerable over here. I cannot do it. I cannot do it so much that I'm willing to die, not to do it. So when we have an impasse in our relationship or a conflict in our relationship, one of us has to do this vaigash. One of us has to. So now you're sitting here. So you, it's on you, because now you know. You know how to resolve the problem. You have the key to resolve the conflict. You know what needs to be done. One of us needs to say, okay, I'm going to put my ego aside and I'm going to do vaigash. I'm going to do that.
Does that person get more brownie points?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm also giving stickers. The reason that we have to understand that if we both stay in the same place when we are, nothing is going to happen. Again, the sky and the earth cannot meet. We have to do this approaching. And the thing that can help us is the realization or the understanding that a good relationship, it's not about me and it's not about the other. It's about what we have together. It's about, in English actually, it's nice. It's like me and me, but if you turn it around, it's we. So it's not about either one of us, it's not about me or me, it's about we. And when we both are working toward this we, then it's successful. Then it's not about my ego or the other person's ego. It's not about who's right or who's wrong. It's not about who is doing the approaching and who is... מבטר. איך הוא מבטר?
Giving up.
לא, give up זה נכנה, לא, אני לא...
Given.
Give, לבטר is good. לבטר is something good, it's positive.
לבטר זה positive?
Yes, very.
So why do we have a negative connotation?
ממש לא, בעיניים שלי.
לא, לבטר.
לבטר.
תוותר
לו, be the bigger man, תוותר. You are bigger, give your brother to play with the car. תוותר לו, be nice.
So in English there's another saying. Huh? There's another thing, actually, there's no I
in team. Team.
But there's me. In team.
Nice try.
I never heard that.
So now, as I said, you know the secret. So it's on you, guys. Just know it, it's on you. Because now you have a tool, you have a knowledge that can serve you in any relationship. It doesn't have to be with your partner, with your husband. It can be with your children. It can be with friends. It can be with coworkers. It can be with your boss. It can be with whomever it is. The more close to us the person, the more difficult it is. But it is possible. It is possible to do this switch from what am I going to gain from it, which is all about me, to how are we going again for it, from this? How is it going to serve us?
But it doesn't mean just because you're going to approach someone that you're always going to get that response. It doesn't mean that second person,
And you also open up a different door.
And different energy.
When you put yourself and you make yourself vulnerable, it shows you, it does something with the other person, I think.
Depending on where the person is. It's about timing and the person. Timing. Yeah.
Also, if you look at the story of Yehuda and Yosef, you see that even though Yehuda did the approaching, Yosef didn't give in so easily. He made him work for it. Like all the way. According to the Mefarshim, it says he wanted to make sure that Yehuda really changed, that it's not an act, that it's genuine, that it's okay. But again, we are not the ruler of Mitzrayim, right?
Okay,
we are not the ruler of Mitzrayim, so we can be more modest than Yosef.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
a little more modest. So whoever you want to be close to, whoever you want to feel close to or be close to, we have to do this going out of our comfort zone, because it's really uncomfortable, and do this vayigash, this approaching, and do this zoom out and look at the bigger picture and understand it's not just about us. If it's always just about me, I'm going to be left alone. You know, I don't remember who told me once, okay, go stand on the tip of the mountain, hold the sign, Ani Tzodeket, and be alone. I don't remember who told me, but somebody told me once. And I said, okay, it's very important for me to be Tzodeket, but I don't want to be on the mountain by myself.
Tamar may be there.
No, she's on the way.
Oh, okay.
On the way. So we have to do this zoom out, look from afar, make our involvement, the emotional involvement, a little less, work more with the brain, give up this ego of ours, understand that together is what we need to work on, and do the vaygash. We have to do this vaygash. This is the tool, this is the key for every resolution of a conflict. And I'm going to bless all of us and all of Israel. Shiyeh Chodesh Tevet.
Amen.
A blessed Chodesh Tevet. Shiyeh Tov Meitiv Tevet. That we're going to hear and you're going to give only good news.
Amen.
For everybody. Chodesh Tov.
Thank you.
Chodesh Tov. Thank you.
And I forgot. I want to bless you, Adele.
Adela. Wait, Adela.
Adela. You have hay in your name.
Yes, I do.
You have hay in your name, which is important.
Maureen, she's trying to bless me. Can you just sit down?
Yes. I want to bless you. First of all, thank you for this hospitality.
My pleasure.
And thank you for all this bounty. And I want to bless you that you're going to always be the one that can give and not take.
Amen.
And that this bounty is gonna, you're gonna be, have this bounty in every area of your life.
Amen.
Whether
Amen.
It's parnasah, whether it's love, shalom bayit, nachat ma'iladim, sipuk ma'avodah,
Amen.
Everything that you need, friendships.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very Amen. Much for this.
Thank you.
Bravo. I like this one. This was a good one. I like this.
I have to share this with quite a few people.